Okay. How's it going? Did you have a good dinner? Yeah? Is that a yes? Yeah? Okay. Good deal. Well, welcome back. Come on. I want you to go ahead and stand on your feet, and let's have a good time worshiping the Lord here tonight. All right? How about these choirs? Yeah, let's welcome the choirs, everybody. Sing this with me.
We've waited for this day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. Oh yeah. You're the reason we're singing.
Front of me is one of the greatest choirs you'll ever hear in your life. This is some of my favorite people in all the world. This is LU Praise. Y'all welcome LU Praise. And we also have the choirs from Cave Springs Baptist Church and Franklin Heights Baptist Church up there, everybody. We are honored that they are with us. You know what? We want to give you a song that was actually born right out of Liberty University. One of our students there wrote this song several years back, and we started doing it at Thomas Road, and then a couple other churches started doing it. Now this song has been sung in over 130 nations worldwide, and this song is sung everywhere, all over, almost every Sunday, and it's a lot of fun to sing. And I think you might recognize it. If you don't, it just goes like this. The chorus goes like this. We bless you, Lord, God of the ages, highest of all, we magnify you. Your name will be exalted, exalted. Raise your hand if you ever heard that song before. Okay, oh good, look at all those hands. All right, well, I want you to help me. Here we go.
He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation. He is the first, the last, the one who matters most.
He is creator.
He is creator. Ruling sustainer of all, he holds it all together. He is the Word for all the world.
His name is lifted higher. Sing that part.
His name is lifted higher.
Jesus, your name is lifted higher.
Till high.
okay, you want us to do those other songs now too? Oh, I thought there was something in between us all. Okay, well, good. We'll just keep on going. That song is written out of Colossians chapter 1, where the Bible says, He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. And just a little bit later on in that chapter, the Bible says this, For all things were created by Him and for Him. I like that. Just as a little reminder, and you know this, but I always tell all these crowds that we're in front of, Jesus didn't just create the trees and the earth and the beautiful oceans and everything else. He created you. You were created by Him, which means you were created for Him. And because of that, He's the only one worthy of our praise. He's the only one worthy of our worship. I'm going to invite you to remain standing because I think you probably know this little worship song. Sing it with me. Bible says that every knee shall bow, every tongue confess to the glory of God the Father that Jesus is Lord, always has been, and always will be. Come on, everybody. Lift your voice. Sing it with me. You will command. You will command the highest praise. Yours is a name above all names. You stand alone, and I stand amazed. Hey, Jesus, only Jesus. Yeah, you will command. You will command. Yours is the name above all. Singing, everybody. We're going to continue to lift up the name of Jesus. You may be seated, but I want to give you a little song that we just entitled, Jesus You Are. This just lifts up the name of Jesus once again. He is King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, worthy of our praise. Sometimes I forget. I think we forget in our worship services. You know, we get so caught up with all the stuff going on and all the production and all just the agenda of the service, that really when it comes down to it, the main thing on the agenda should be real simple. Just lift up the name of Jesus. Just lift him up. If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me. So I want to give you a little song that's simply entitled, Jesus, You Are. John 14:6. He is the way, the truth, the life. Castle built upon the sand, but I will trust your heart even through the dark. On your love is where I'll stand. You are the way, you are the truth. Things unseen. Oh, but there's a still small voice calling through the noise, saying, come and follow. With me and sing it, everybody, all right?
Wow. Charles, I think you've got a keeper there. That is fantastic. Well, welcome home again, SBCV family. Dr. Autry tells me that we are just shy and right on the doorstep of 1,000 so far here for this year's 20th anniversary celebration. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, I want to introduce to you, it's my privilege for you to have this dear brother and personal friend to lead us in prayer tonight, Dr. Stan Paris and his wife Susan. She's here in the room tonight. He is pastor of Franklin Heights Baptist Church, and they have planted a satellite. Now, he serves in Rocky Mount, and they've been a part of SBCV for almost 5 years, and full-time, and they've dove all the way in with us, being uniquely aligned, and planted a church stand. That was about 2 years ago out there at the lake. They are running 700 to 800 at their second location. And I want to tell you what, you want to see a church and a pastor and a church family that is capturing a city in Virginia with the gospel of Jesus Christ, just look to Stan Paris and Franklin Heights Baptist Church. It is a great work they're doing. Stan, welcome. Would you please come and welcome him as he leads us in prayer tonight?
Thank you. Let's bow as we pray together tonight. Dear Jesus, you stand alone. I stand amazed. We thank you, Jesus, that you are holy. You are righteous. You are the King. You are our Creator tonight. And God, we are humbled to be in your presence. And God, tonight I pray for every church that's represented in this room. I pray, Lord, that through them, your servants, you would do a great work. May we, Lord, experience a great awakening, a great movement of your Holy Spirit. And God, we thank you for the gospel of Jesus Christ that changes lives, that saves people, and gives us hope. Thank you, Lord, for the SBC of Virginia and for the great work that you're doing through these people. We thank you, Lord, for the leadership of Dr. Autry and all that you're doing through him. I pray, Lord, your blessing over him. And God, tonight we are praying, Lord, as you are looking for that person in this generation to stand in the gap for you. Father, I pray I would be that person. I pray those in this room, their churches would be those churches. Yes. And Lord, I pray the SBC of Virginia would be the convention that will stand in the gap for you. And Lord, we pray a prayer of thanksgiving for the changed lives that we've heard about the last couple of days. And Lord, we pray that you would do it again, send another revival, another great movement of your Holy Spirit. Bless this night, Lord, we pray, with a powerful presence of your Spirit. May you do a great work in your heart as the Word of God is proclaimed. And we thank you, Lord, most of all for the gift of salvation we have through Jesus Christ, our Savior. And I make this prayer in his great name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Stan. God bless you. It is time for our executive director's report from Dr. Brian Autry. But really, report's not a good word for it, Brian. Maybe a presentation. No, I think we could do a little bit better than that. Maybe inspiration. No, with what you're going to share with us tonight, it's going to be a time of celebration. Amen. Would you welcome our executive director this
Thank
evening?
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. God bless you. Thank you so much. Well, it is my privilege on behalf of our over 700 churches to share with you this presentation this evening, and on behalf of our ministry team and church planners and missionaries serving. You know, this evening we meet here at this historic church, a church with a tremendous legacy, but a church, even though it is so historic, a church that is evangelistic and vibrant. We can consider the work that God does through a church like this, through the church that you just heard testified about. You can consider the work of each and every church represented here this evening. And that brings us to this point, to consider why we join in this work together. Inerrancy of Scripture, sanctity of life, purity of marriage, necessity of salvation in Christ alone. These are all principles, all fundamentals that have united us for the past 20 years. And even this past Saturday, as churches came from our SBCV family to gather here before this homecoming meeting was to take place and to reach out to the valley to see those 30-some souls come to Christ on Saturday is a reason to rejoice. So this evening, I come before you to remind us as a convention that it is the Great Commission that unites us. It is our firm theology, but make no mistake about it, we do not just hold the Bible sacred, we understand it is in the Bible. It is because of the Word of God that people can come to know the blessed name of Jesus. Amen? Now, what is our mission? Well, our mission as the SBC of Virginia, I want to just share this with you as we have just unveiled this renewed mission. Our mission is to strengthen and mobilize churches to make disciples and to plant churches through gospel partnership. Now that's our mission, but what is his vision? What's his vision? His vision is for us to reach the world for Christ. Revelation chapter 7, verse 9 and 10. You don't need my words. Quite honestly, I don't need your words. I need the words of Christ. I need to know his vision for this work, and it's found in Revelation 7. After this, I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes, peoples, and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Ladies and gentlemen, men and women, this evening, I submit to you that vision. That ought to be the vision that guides us. That's why we plant churches as a convention of churches. That's why you, as churches, you're planting churches. That's why you're strengthening one another. That's why you're mobilized in this Great Commission endeavor. It's that vision. But think about that for a moment. A great multitude that no one could number. Every nation, all tribes, all peoples, all languages. That means that we're not necessarily going to always look like each other. That means that we're not always going to necessarily sound like one another. That means that I might have been born on this side of the tracks and you on that side of the tracks. It may mean that some of us going to have a little bit more cash in our pockets than others. Let's tonight walk away from this place with that sense of vision. Every nation, all tribes, peoples, and languages. Just over the past year, we have witnessed how right here in our land, even in our state, in our nation, the nation we call home, we've witnessed tremendous division. We've taken positions, we've heard the politics, we voted in the election. But let's remember what we just sang about. Our Lord Jesus Christ is on the throne. Our Lord Jesus Christ reigns forever and ever. He will never be up for re-election. Let's understand his vision this evening. We belong to him. Amen? We must have this vision, ladies and gentlemen. This is what unites us. I want to ask you to do something with me now. Would you just say the Lord's Prayer with me aloud? Together, our Father, who art in heaven. Just stop right there. Hold on just a second. Just start that over again. Ready? Our Father, who art... Just hold. Excuse me. Hold on a second. Would you start it over again? Ready? You're saying the right prayer. Don't get worried. Would you just start over again with me? Ready? Just stop right there. The Lord Jesus didn't teach me to pray in that prayer, my Father. He taught me to pray, our Father. This theme, not alone, it looks nice on a banner, I guess. But ladies and gentlemen, you don't just need more banners. We need we need the heart cry of God to take root in us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Our Father. That's why this evening we want his vision. We want to once again come together after 20 years as a convention of churches to once again reaffirm that we shall not be alone. We shall not attempt this mission on our own. We are not alone. Watch this now and consider that thought.
SBCV has been a great partner with me. All of us need to recognize we can't do the work that God has called us to do all by ourselves.
Because of our partnership, our church plant was able to get off the ground, receive prayer and funding and support.
We had regional help right there, living in our area, there to assist.
Learning how to love one another and encourage each other in everything that God is doing. So we're all growing.
Our churches have come together in our state convention in unity and in harmony.
So thank you, SBC of Virginia, for allowing us to join together for the work of the Lord. From being part of the SBC of Virginia, we naturally had fellowship.
They are there in relationship with you, whether it's personally with you, whether it's praying with you, and it's kingdom-minded.
To me, that's what the SBCV is all about. It's a convention where we know.
We're not alone.
We are not alone.
Not alone.
We are not alone.
We are not alone.
We are not alone.
Not alone.
Not alone.
We're not alone.
We're not alone.
It is the gospel. And when we stand together, that's exactly what God will allow us to be a part of.
Amen. Amen. Now, by the way, LU Praise will be back. They just don't want me to sing with them. They'll be back in a few moments, all right? Don't you worry. Not alone. Not alone because we strengthen one another. Over the past year, we've seen our churches come together at Youth Evangelism Conference, Centrifuge Camps, the Prayer Summit, where over 300 gathered in Chesapeake on the other side of the state, the Empowered Conference, a Super Vacation Bible School and Kids Conference that absolutely amazed those who came to lead that. And folks from all around the nation were commenting on that as over 600 children's leaders gathered to learn how they could better share the gospel with boys and girls in Virginia. A worship technology conference where we're coming to understand how technology can be used to glorify God as we worship together with one another. At a Fusion Mission Week, just a few miles from here, 28 made decisions for Christ. Our Deaf Leaders Conference taking place, Hispanic leaders now gathering together, and just last month, our Pastor Wise Retreat. We want you to know that SBC of Virginia stands with you, so you will not be alone, because not alone, we strengthen one another. Now, I want you to hear from a man who appreciates what you're doing as you lead your church. I want you to hear from Tony Evans, a special challenge that I want to ask us to take to heart. Watch this.
Hello, and this is Dr. Tony Evans, and I'm inviting all the Southern Baptist Conservatives of Virginia to join us for the National Church Adopt a School Initiative training. It will be March 24th at the Fellowship Community Church in Salem. This is a time when we equip churches to adopt public schools so that they can provide mentoring, tutoring, family support services to impact every community, because every church already has a school nearby and the families that make up that school. Church, school, and family, that's community, that's the whole nation. So join us March 24th at Fellowship Community Church in Salem. You can log on to churchadoptheschool.org. That's churchadoptheschool.org to register.
Now that opportunity, that training is going to take place right here in the Roanoke area. So the first challenge, the first announcement of the first headline I want to share with our convention this evening is this. It is our prayer that over the next year, every single SBC of Virginia church will adopt a school in their community. Can you voice your support and your willingness to at least pray about that challenge to adopt local schools in your community? That is a place where people from all around your locality come together. And I tell you what, your school is waiting, but perhaps wondering if you will reach out to them. You come and you consider that challenge as churches adopt schools. Well, it's not just about us. Being a Christian and growing stronger isn't just for our own benefit. It's because Christ wants to work in and through us. We're not alone in strengthening one another, but we're not alone in mobilizing for His mission. Over the past year, we've seen tremendous mobilization of our disaster relief volunteers. February, tornadoes struck Virginia. Summer, flooding. Over 65,000 meals alone were served in Virginia and West Virginia as we did flood relief. Appalachian missionary Matt Clunch has hiked the entire Appalachian Trail, and he's been serving on your behalf because of your giving through the Vision Virginia mission offering. He's been hiking that trail, leading people to Christ. We've had a missionary on the Appalachian Trail, and you probably didn't even know that. In Greece, teams have been helping with the refugee crisis ever since that crisis began to take place. And we continue to work and minister there to those who have experienced tremendous loss and anguish. I had the privilege of being there myself back this past winter, and to sit there and to pray with people, and to pray with people in Jesus' name, to have people ask you, please pray with me, to see people struggling, moms and dads trying to come to terms with how they were going to explain to their children that they were never, most likely ever, going to go back to their hometown. In Montreal, we continue to minister. I think about what's been happening in Nepal, in Asia, where just a handful of years ago, this village was beheading anybody who claimed Christ as their Lord. Yet now, because of outreach and ministry through SBC of Virginia churches, over 600 volunteer days served, equivalent over this past year. Now that village has decided to donate a piece of property in that village so a church can be built. In a village where just a few years ago, Christians were being beheaded. Now they're saying, you know what, because of the ministry you're doing, because of what you've done to minister to our community ravaged by the earthquake, we now believe in what you're doing. We want you here to stay. Here's a piece of land. Please, will you now build a church? I think about the ride for the unborn. I think about how even this past May, our executive board went out on ministry in this community instead of just being in a board meeting, and we saw a couple dozen folks come to Christ simply because they were serving meals and having a block party. Faith Riders Evangelism in Sturgis, South Dakota. And we could go on and on and on how SBC Virginia churches are being mobilized across the board to take Christ to our neighbors and the nations. But especially right now, I want to take a moment, even though we've mobilized globally, I want to take a particular moment to thank our disaster relief volunteers. This has been a tremendous year of response and demand placed on these volunteers who often serve. They do not want to be in the spotlight. I would not dare ask them to come on stage because they want to serve. They're not looking for the spotlight. But would you join me in showing your love and appreciation and your commitment to pray for our disaster relief volunteers that come from your churches? Would you put your hands together and show your appreciation? I want to ask Brandon Pickett to come now and share with you an interview with, Jeff Ginn.
Dr. Ginn, come on up here, please, because, you know, one of the places that we were mobilized this year was a place that you just happened to live in. Can you share with us what happened with this incredible, what do you call it, not just a century, it's a once-in-a-lifetime flood?
We are from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. That's where we serve the Lord now. And we typically, in a given year, will receive about 60 inches of rain, just under 60 inches of rain. But in one 15-hour period, we received over 30 inches of rain. So you think half a day, half a year's rain. And we already were soaked. And so it was just more than we could absorb. And so we had about 100,000 homes flooded there in our area. We refer to it as the Great Flood of 2016.
What was going through your mind, like, that night or the next day? How do you even process that?
Well, of course, in Louisiana, there's a lot of flooding that happens. And so my heart was going out to the people of our community. And I knew that it was likely that our church would be tapped as a place for preparation of meals and disaster relief. And so I waded out through the waters in my street to a high point where I could catch transportation back to our church. And I thought for sure our home would be safe. And I left my wife there and one of our sons there at home and went to the church to get ready to do disaster relief.
So Nell is there. You're going to church. Nell's there. And so you're thinking, I'm going to minister to other people. But that's not just what happened, huh?
Right. Yes, our home as well received about 28 inches of rain, so you can think just above your knee. And every home in our neighborhood was flooded. And so we, you know, it's an interesting thing. I would never want to be here standing giving a testimony of what disaster relief means. But, of course, I'm glad to do it now because we were the recipients of their help. You don't want to be a part of a disaster, but I don't know if you can identify with this, and I'm speaking particularly to those of you who are pastors, but I remember hearing a story about a missionary. He was trying to do ministry to lepers, and he went as a healthy man to serve among the lepers, and he preached to them, and his heart was to win them, but it was as though they didn't pay him any attention. But because he was exposed to the leprosy, at one point, he actually contracted leprosy, and so he stood up to preach as he did every Sunday, but this time he began his sermon, "We Lepers." And when the lepers heard him say that now they realized he was one of them, they lent him their ears, they heard the message. And so, though you'd never want to go through the flood, for Nell and me, in a sense, we're almost glad that we're able to say we, and we identify with our people, what they've suffered, we've suffered, and I think it gives us a unique hearing then as we proclaim the gospel and the hope that's in Christ.
Yeah, I was just thinking that here you were as a number of years as executive director mm-hmm. of the SBC of Virginia, and you were the ones who really helped us start our mobilizing team. Isn't it amazing in God's providence that now you're the recipient of the SBCV disaster mm-hmm. relief team?
It is, and we're very grateful, and we didn't want to be recipients of it. And actually, Mark Gauthier, who leads some of those ministries, was down in Louisiana helping spearhead that. And he said, we want to send a team to your home. And we said, no, we don't want a team to come to our home. And it was genuine. We really didn't. We thought, you know, there's so many people who need it more than we. But once they came and ministered to us, we realized firsthand how important that is. And the needs, even in our own home, were greater than we realized initially. And so we want to say on behalf of all of the people there in the greater Baton Rouge area, a heartfelt thank you to the SBCV and your disaster relief teams. Those volunteers, may God bless you and repay you for your kindness to us.
One last question, yeah. And that is about Vision Virginia, because I also remember when we started what was already the state mission offering, what we named it Vision Virginia, and you had a saying I loved. It was helping the mission force of the church go to the mission field. Mm. And so now we see that happening, and do you have any thoughts for us about Vision Virginia moving into the future and helping not just Louisiana, but wherever God leads us?
Well, you all have the vision, and I want to encourage you as you pursue it. That saying, as I remember it was, you're either a part of the mission field or you're going to be a part of the mission force. And the SBCV is a great part of God's mission force impacting the world. You're going into the fields, and we love you and thank God for you, our brothers and sisters.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ginn. Let's let him know how much we love him. And Nell, God bless you. Dr. Autry, we're going to take it back to you.
Well, one of the things that's gripped us this past year is not only seeing the opportunity to serve right here amongst our own loved ones and our own state and our own nation, but also is the global immensity before us of need. That's why, and not only encouraging our churches to adopt a local school this evening, I also want to announce to our convention that our executive board has approved, and we are ready to launch out, already have begun to launch out, a new initiative. And I'm pleased to announce this to our convention this year, a new initiative we're calling Virginia Global Response. And Virginia Global Response will be about taking the gospel to the ends of the earth, working in partnership with our International Mission Board. But this will be, I call it, preaching the gospel with work boots on. Because the reality will be to meet practical human need, humanitarian need, meeting the need all across the world as we've been having opportunity, but now in an organized platform, Virginia Global Response. But that can't take place. We can't truly mobilize to respond to these global needs without your support, without your prayers, without you joining together with us continually through the co-op program and through our Vision Virginia offering. Not alone as we strengthen one another, not alone as we mobilize for his mission, and not alone also as churches plant churches. Of course, across our state, we've been privileged this year to encourage 89 church plants and church planting small groups. Just think about that. Over 10% of our churches are actually in their first few years of being birthed and started. That's tremendous. They need our prayers. They need our partnership. They need us to come alongside them. Almost 6,000 people worship weekly in these church plants, churches that are less than 5 years of age. Almost 500 baptisms. More than $300,000 given through the cooperative program. We also have been encouraged to see increased support and trying to provide increased encouragement to our church planter wives. Also, encouraging our deaf church planting leaders, a new initiative that was launched. A goal that we've had for a number of years is that 10% of SBC of Virginia churches would sponsor a church plant. This year, and we really encourage your prayers last year about this year, I'm pleased to report to you that we have crossed that threshold for the first time in our history in 20 years, over 10% of SBC of Virginia churches sponsoring church plants. And the news is also encouraging. Over 18% of SBC of Virginia churches reported to us this year that they are involved in sponsoring SBCV church plants or churches beyond the work that's taking place right here. 18%, almost one-fifth. But I just used the word sponsoring, and that's changing. After 20 years, that's changing. We are now adopting the term, instead of sponsor churches, partner churches, because it's not just about sponsoring someone. It's about being in partnership. This is a gospel partnership. It's a two-way street. You know, I receive so much as a church planter, but I like to think I encourage those who sponsored me. And you know, I can guarantee you that church planters, well, they're encouraged greatly by you. You minister a lot to them, but I'm betting they might minister a whole lot to you as well. Folks, that's partnership. That's what Paul gave thanksgiving for when he wrote about it in Philippians chapter 1. Gospel partnership. I'd like you to hear from one of our church planters right now. This is Jason Lamb. Watch this on the video screen with me.
Hey guys, my name is Jason Lamb. I'm the lead pastor of Rising Church in Leesburg, Virginia. A church plant just a little over a year old, and I am so grateful for our partnership with the SBC of Virginia. Because of our partnership, our church plant was able to get off the ground, receive prayer and funding and support through your giving to Vision Virginia, the cooperative program. You guys have blessed us extraordinarily. I have been grateful even for individual churches who've reached out and begun to walk alongside of us through giving, through encouragement, through prayer, through mission teams. We have been able to do so much more as Rising Church and a young church plant because of the partnership with the SBCV. So from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much. Because of our partnership together in the SBCV, we are not alone.
Well, since our founding, one of our core values has stated this: our future is church planting. But now at our 20th anniversary, I want to say thank you for being about church planting. But I have a third announcement to make, and this is it. We've been about church planting, and we will continue to be about church planting, but we must also be about church revitalization. As we move forward into this next decade of ministry together, we will, on one hand, be about church planting, but we will also be about revitalizing churches. It must be our heart cry that no church will be left behind. No church will be left out of the Great Commission, and all churches will be strengthened. All churches will be mobilized. All churches will make disciples. Amen? Amen. That's our heart cry. That's our commitment tonight to you. Now, we need to pray about that, because that's kind of my going to the moon statement, revitalizing churches. We don't really know how to do it. I was talking to Frank Page about it today. Really, honestly, there are not very many folks in the entire Southern Baptist Convention that seem to know how to do it. But we've got to try. Our Lord Jesus said he will build his church. Just a little bit, you're going to hear from a preacher who's going to call us to preach the word and to exalt Jesus. Folks, I don't know the strategy behind revitalizing churches, but we want to stand with you. We want to stand with you and other churches in the days ahead. Whether you're a 15-year-old church that needs revitalizing, or a 150-year-old church, or a 300-year-old church, we have some of those in Virginia. We want to stand with you because not alone must be more than a theme. And we were founded 20 years ago based on biblical inerrancy. It was never our goal to be the biggest. It was simply our goal to be biblical. I want to ask you to join together this evening in renewing our belief, in once again saying, we believe. Would you stand to your feet and let's hear and receive this message in song? We believe. Will you say that with me aloud? We believe. Will you say that with me again? We believe.
Time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe in this broken. Dark universe, there is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit. And he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And he's coming back again. We believe.
Face.
Go ahead and be seated if you would. In Acts 18, the Lord said to Paul one night in a vision, "Do not be afraid, but go on speaking, and do not be silent, for I am with you, and no one will attack you to harm you, for I have many in this city who are my people." Church, I just want to tell you tonight, number one, don't be afraid. Number two, don't be silent. And number three, don't be alone. Watch and listen.
In the beginning, God and community said, "Let us make man in our image," creates life from dust. From his lips, existence was stitched from his mumblings. He said, "It's finished," but he still wasn't done with us. You're not alone. Never left behind, no child is. Tears in my eyes as I write this, penning lines of enlightenment, hoping to criticize the indictment of the accuser who says to the created, "Did God say?" Yes, he did. We are not alone. We are the God-owned. God alone makes it plain. Cross-stained, narrow gate. Eliminate the sinner's fate by switching place. Crooked path, get it straight. The ill-fated inundated with his amazing grace. We are the canvas on which the Ancient of Days paints his story. The framework he uses to get his glory. One portrait full of different hues of the redeemed, crying, "Holy, holy, holy, and not alone." Unified. Now everywhere I go, I see my bloodline. Every culture, color, Jew and Gentile, sisters and brothers, a family like no other. White, black, theologian, businessman, B-boy, reaching out to the elite and the D-boy, and we want you with us. Be encouraged when you really see your family tree. Resources aren't limited, you got more family than me. When we lock arms in Christ, it shifts eternity. One body, one spirit, one God we please. Our mission is the greatest collective endeavor ever. We can do less apart, but it's limitless together. What we do in this time impacts forever. Loving those who don't know him as they turn to confessors. You aren't just an outreach, you're an outpost of heaven. We aren't just a church, we are who the King dwells in. Cultures change, empires bend knees as God steps in. And this is just what happens because we're connected. Don't ever think you're alone. I beseech you, brethren, through the ages the church has stood on the rock for shelter. Despite every storm and wind that's come against to test us, when the sun brings his rain, we're not disturbed with the weather. Every person in ministry, everyone tired, fighting the good fight, at some point felt uninspired. Know that our God is a consuming fire. Whatever embers you have left, he will blow and new life comes. You've got family praying for you globally, locking arms in the spirit, saying the church of Christ will prevail and Satan can't come near it. Shouting from the rooftops, and we just pray he hears it. Did God say? Yes, he did. You are not alone. I will never forsake or leave, so therefore I will never grieve. He bled for me, therefore I forever cleave to the King who gave all for me. You, us, together, my family, my God, his spirit, we're wedded. He sees us. I am that I am will never leave us. We are not alone.
Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Sing that with me.
Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
I hope you heard the words of that great song. You can't help but miss the beauty of the singing of that choir. But he says to trust him. He'll go with us through every circumstance, through every situation, through every battle, through every valley. Don't you wish life was just one mountaintop after the next? Well, it can be with the Lord, but at the same time, to get from one mountaintop to the next, you gotta go back down through another valley. It's in the valley that we worship, learn to worship the Lord. I've often said this, and it really is true. If you praise the Lord on the mountaintops and don't do it in the valleys, it's not praise of the Lord at all, it's just praise of your feelings. His worth doesn't depend on our mood or our circumstance or our situation. He's worthy all the time. So trust him through the battle. Trust him through the good times. Trust him through the bad times. And surrender all that you are to him. At the beginning, in the middle, and at the end of every day. Because he's the only one who can carry you through it all. And then when you get to the other side, you can look back. And you can rest assured, our God is good. He's so, so good.
Lord, I surrender all to your strong and faithful hand. In everything I will give thanks to you, and I'll just trust your perfect plan. When I don't know what to do, when I don't know what to say,
I'll speak your prayer.
When I don't know where to go,
I'll run to your throne.
When I don't know what to think,
I'll stand on on your truth when I don't know what to do.
It just dawned on me, Adam, when we recorded this song, I guess about 8 years ago now, I had three singers singing with me. I had LU Praise, and we were at Thomas Road with a choir, and LU Praise was backing us up, but over to the side, I had three background singers that I had hired, all the best of the best. And the lady who sang all the BGVs and all the ad-libs and everything was suddenly found dead in her kitchen last night. About 40 years old, mother, wife. It's just that life, folks, is like a vapor. We don't know when our last day is coming. We don't know what's coming tomorrow. We don't know when we're going to get that phone call that we don't know how to explain, and we don't know where to turn, and we don't know where to go, and we're just at a loss for words. We don't know when that's going to happen, but I promise you, a good many people in this room have had that phone call, haven't you? Maybe you've had that report from the doctor. Maybe you've been in that situation where you had no income, you had no job. Maybe you've been in a situation where your family turned their back on you, or your kids walked away from the Lord. I don't know the situation, but I do know this. The Lord wants us to surrender it all to His feet, into His hands, and trust Him, no matter the battle, no matter the circumstance. So our response, even in the depths of the valley, should always be one thing and one thing only: to trust Him, and then to worship Him. I think about her family right now. I wonder if this song has come to their mind. As I bow my knee, send your perfect peace, send your perfect peace, Lord. And as I lift my hands, let your healing come, let your healing come to me. As I bow my knee, send your perfect peace, send your perfect peace, Lord. And as I lift my hands, let your healing come, let your healing come to me, Lord. As I bow my knee, send your perfect peace, send your perfect peace to me, Lord. And as I lift my hands, oh, I will lift my hands, let your healing hand, let it come to me, Lord. Oh, and as I bow my knee, send your perfect peace, send your perfect peace to me, Lord. Oh, and as I lift my hands, oh, I will daily lift my hands, and let your healing come.
Now that is a powerful time of worship. Thank you, LU Praise, so much for being here. Thank you, choirs. You can be dismissed, choirs. Thank you so much. It was such a joy and a privilege to have you here on our 20th anniversary. Thank you, and of course, Charles and Van, thank you so much. When I don't know what to do. And that's what biblical foundations are all about, our core values, and we've been talking about them now for a couple days. Our core values, we started with that biblical foundation, and then we went to fervent prayer. And our next really core value we're going to talk about is local church and how important local church is to the SBC of Virginia. And when I was thinking about someone who could really speak to this value, one name came to mind, and many could have done it, but one name came to mind, and that was Dr. Michael Fitzgerald from Clifford Baptist Church. So, Dr. Fitzgerald, please welcome him as he comes and speaks on local church.
Thank you, Brandon. Thank you. I am honored to stand before you tonight, my brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ, and sister churches, and we serve together. And how grateful I am to be here. I am amazed that Brandon Pickett picked up the phone a couple of months ago and said, Pastor Mike, would you simply speak on the value of the local church? Friends, I want you to know that hits a sweet spot with me to speak about the church. My heart beats for the love of Jesus Christ. It beats for the love of my family. And it beats for the love of the church I serve. I am so grateful to be before you tonight. I'm grateful for the ministry of the local church in my life. I was saved. I gave my heart and soul and life to Jesus Christ in the ministry of a local church in Stanton, Virginia. I'm so grateful that I grew up under pastors and teachers in Sunday school and mentors throughout the years who molded me to be the man of God that the Lord wants me to be. And I'm still growing in that process. But I'm grateful for all of those people across the years who served that for me. I'm grateful that God called me to be a pastor of a local church when I was in the sixth grade. I knew that that was going to be my life and my service for the rest of my life to serve the local church. And so I went through high school and I went through college knowing I'm going to be the pastor of a local church. And then I went on to Southeastern Baptist Seminary to become trained to be that pastor that God wanted me to be. And while I was there, I met a young lady who came to seminary as well. Her name was Gwen Foster. And Gwen came to seminary because she had heard that in order to be on the foreign mission field, you would need some seminary training and some seminary credits. And so she came to seminary thinking perhaps God would send her to the foreign mission field, and then she met me. And we fell in love, and we got married, and God did indeed put her on the mission field in a little place called Clifford, Virginia. Now, you know where Roanoke is, you know where Richmond is, you know where Lynchburg is, you know where Hampton Roads is. Do you know where Clifford, Virginia is? Very few do. But as I've told my church over and over, you know, it really doesn't matter that anybody knows where Clifford, Virginia is. It really doesn't matter if anybody knows the name of Clifford Baptist Church. Our desire, our mission, our ministry is to lift up the Savior we serve, the one we love, the one we want to take into the world to share with others so that they too may know Him and that salvation relationship. So tonight, Clifford, Virginia has a Great Commission church there. And I'm grateful to tell you tonight that we have adopted that little elementary school in Amherst, Virginia. And we take a Good News Club there every Monday. And I have not only baptized children from that Good News Club, but entire families from that Good News Club. Adopt that school. It's so very important. But tonight I want you to think about your community, whether it's a city or a town or this little rural outpost. I'm sure there are many Clifford, Virginias here tonight. In fact, as I was walking through the parking lot, I saw a church van from Meharon, Virginia. I have no idea where that is. But I know I have brothers and sisters there. I want to meet you. I'm grateful that we come together and serve together. And of course, I believe that with this recent election, that our country has been given a gift of God. And I believe that there are some things about our country that can absolutely change for the better. And we pray for our government that is yet to come. However, this is what I believe, that the church that lifts up Jesus Christ and the church that preaches His inerrant word and the church that goes out on mission, we are the world changers. We are the ones who can bring the love of Christ and true change to a country in dire need. In 1987, I wrote a dissertation, and I found this definition of the church. I could never forget it. It says this: the local church does not just belong to the universal church of Jesus Christ. The local church is the church. Each ecclesia, each congregation, however small, however poor, is a full and perfect manifestation of the church of Jesus Christ. And so what I want you to know tonight is, your church and my church are important in the kingdom of God. And we have a great commission to carry out as we take Jesus into this world. Paul loved the church. St. Paul loved the church so much that about one half of our New Testament is composed of letters written to churches for leadership and direction and correction, and letters to pastors to teach them how to lead the church. And I believe Paul's greatest definitive statement about the church is in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, where he simply says, Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. When we think about that, when we truly come to terms with that, we realize that the church in which we carry out ministry, your church, my church, and our communities, we were established there by the very love and sacrifice of Jesus Christ, that we might be His voice and His hands and His feet in that community. Your church is important where you are. Tonight, I'm grateful that we joined together because our churches can change the world. And I believe that they change the world one life at a time. Jesus gives this definition in Matthew chapter 7 and Luke chapter 13, saying that coming to Him is entering through a straight gate, a narrow gate. Basically, what Jesus is saying is that gate will only admit through one person at a time. And so our churches change the world one life at a time. We're grateful to know that we extend that love of Christ, that we extend that invitation to new life through Him as we live in our communities. You know, my outlook and my attitude about the church really gained a new perspective about 23 years ago. Clifford Baptist Church is a country church. And my little daughter, Carrie Joy, and I, 23 years ago, were walking through the darkened sanctuary of that church that night, only the two of us there. And as we were walking through, she stopped and she said, Daddy, why do all these other people come to our church? And in that moment, I thought, Lord, that little girl owns this church. She loves this church. She continues to this day to love that church. However, as the Lord spoke to me when Carrie said that, I thought, how do I lead my church family as pastor of the church to love the church with that kind of ownership, to want to give their life to the Lord Jesus Christ through the ministry of the church? Because we realize tonight that the church is not simply a collection of visitors. We're a gathering of investors. We have invested our life in Christ, and He then turns to use us in His kingdom's work, that we might reach out with the love of Jesus to a lost and dying and hurting world. And we know that love for Him begins in our personal, intimate relationship with Him. But then we know that every believer, and I believe this from the bottom of my heart, every believer should be a part of the local church. Every believer should have an investment in the local church. Yes, you can worship in the woods on a stump by yourself, but nothing can take the place of gathering together as the church of Jesus Christ, worshiping Him, praising Him, studying His word, praying together. Nothing can take that place, because the church is the only earthly institution that Jesus established. And if that is so, then absolutely it is important in his eyes. We need to overcome what I would call the movie theater mentality. In a movie theater, the strangers come in and they're entertained for 2 hours, and then the strangers get up and they leave. But that's not what the church is at all. The church is a family, and the church shares life together and shares ministry and calling and mission together. And so we're family in that we love one another and we walk with one another and we celebrate and grieve with one another and we join together to carry out the great commission of Jesus to take his love into the world. We are family and we do invest our lives in that local church under the grace of Jesus Christ. It is a living, thriving body that we join together. Jesus gives us that great commission of Matthew 28 that we go into all the nations and we teach his truth and we baptize believers. My prayer for every congregation represented here tonight is that we will bring our church families to the Lord. That we will lay those church families at his throne of grace and blessing and calling and perhaps healing and ask him to use us in mighty ways. Together we thank him that he's called us to be his church, his people. And now in response to that calling, we go out by his grace and his love and his joy and his blessing, and we are called to change the world, one life at a time. God bless your church. God bless our churches together, big cities, towns, and little rural places where nobody knows about us. But every church that lives for Jesus Christ is an important ministry in his eyes. May God bless and use your church, because it is truly a miraculous tool in his hands. And we can see him change the world as he uses us as his people. You know, 2,000 years ago, Jesus took 12 men to change the world. And I believe in this day and in this age, the Lord Jesus Christ can take some 700 churches in Virginia, and by his power and his grace, he can use us to change the world. Praise God.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for that good word, Michael. God bless you, my brother, and thank you for your ministry. When we were in Columbus, Ohio for the Southern Baptist Convention, I was blessed to hear a sermon by a preacher I had not known nor heard of before. His name is H.B. Charles, Jr. I was so blessed and impressed by his word that night that he brought from God's word that I introduced myself and I said, I would love to have you come to a place like Roanoke, Virginia. Have you ever been before? And he said, no, but I'll come if I can. And some months later he did, and he came with Dr. Johnny Hunt, and we had about over 600 men gathered together and over in what we call Faith Chapel, the older worship center. What a night it was, as H.B. Charles, Jr. set the table for us in preaching and delivering God's word. He is from Jacksonville, Florida, and he serves as the pastor teacher of Shiloh Metropolitan Baptist Church there. Prior to that, he served for 18 years as the pastor of Mount Sinai Missionary Baptist Church, where he began pastoring following his father at the age of 17. He has written and published books. He preaches often in conferences and conventions and revivals. He reminds me of that rocket ship. And he starts out here and he ends up there. Would you please welcome H.B. Charles, Jr. to the Southern Baptist Conservatives of Virginia service tonight. Welcome home. God bless you. Would you join with me as we pray for him tonight? Father, we ask in Jesus' name that you would bless our brother and my friend. I pray that you will fill him with your Holy Spirit, and Father, that you would pour him out to the uttermost. We thank you for the word you've laid on his heart. Now we pray for freedom and power as he delivers it to us this evening. In Jesus' name, amen.
God bless you. Grace and peace be multiplied to each of you tonight in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. To my friend and brother for the warm words of introduction. It is a joy to be here with you tonight. If you would get your copy of God's Word and make your way with me to 2 Timothy chapter 4. Father, we do indeed thank you for the privilege to hear your word tonight and be reminded of our charge to faithfully proclaim the word and the testimony of Jesus Christ. I pray that you would use me to speak your word faithfully and clearly and ready our hearts to receive with meekness the implanted word that is able to save our souls and help us to be doers of the word, not hearers only, lest we deceive ourselves. And as the seed of the word is planted and watered tonight, we know that only you can give the increase. So we reserve for you the highest praise and full credit for all of the fruit that shall come from this time. In Jesus' name, amen. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, we find tonight a call to faithful ministry. Hear the word of the Lord. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Amen. A call to faithful ministry. James Montgomery Boyce served the historic 10th Presbyterian Church in City Center, Philadelphia for 30 years until his death in the year 2000. A faithful Bible expositor, radio preacher, Bible commentator, Boyce is also remembered as a Christian statesman. In that role, he served as the chairman of the International Council of Biblical Inerrancy, which served together for 10 years to defend the inspiration, infallibility, and inerrancy of the sacred scriptures. In 1988, the council disbanded, having finished its intended goals. But in the 1994 edition of Boyce's book, Standing on the Rock, he suggested that the battle for the Bible would continue in the years to come, but it would be somewhat different in the future. He claimed that in the past, the battle for the Bible had been over the inspiration of Scripture, but that in the future, the battle for the Bible would be over the sufficiency of Scripture. Unfortunately, that ominous warning has come to pass in our day and time, where there are many these days who would readily affirm the authority of the Word of God, but they ignore it, neglect it, and in some instances outright reject it by turning to everything but the Word of God to convert, to edify, to reach the lost, to sanctify the church, to reform society. And in our day and time, faithfulness to the gospel of Jesus Christ requires that we earnestly contend for the sufficiency of Scripture, not just the inerrancy of Scripture. We must do ministry in a way that demonstrates our confidence in the Word of God. And simply tonight, I contend that the best way to defend the sufficiency of the Word of God is to simply preach the Word of God. Unfortunately, there is a conspiracy against preaching in the day and time that we live in. The unbelieving world around us dismisses preaching outright as foolishness. Too many congregations would prefer pulpit entertainment rather than faithful exposition. And too many pastors these days want to be life coaches, whatever that is, rather than heralds of the Lord Jesus Christ. This should not surprise us. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1, Paul says, "But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. There will come times of trouble. There will come perilous times." He will go on to explain what those difficult times will look like in the succeeding verses. And as you read those verses, you really can't tell if you're reading ancient scripture or this morning's USA Today. Yet, Paul does not give Timothy a new strategy for the changing times. He exhorts Timothy to stick with the scriptures no matter what's going on in the world around him. And the reason why he should maintain his confidence in the scriptures is stated in the final verses of chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. "For all scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching and for rebuke and for correction and for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work." I declare to you tonight, friends, that it is and has always been the will of God to save the lost and to sanctify the church through faithful, biblical, gospel-saturated, Christ-exalted, Spirit-empowered preaching of the Word. Yes. Romans 10 verses 14 and 15 ask, "How shall they call on him of whom they have not believed? And how can they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without someone preaching to them? And how shall they preach unless they be sent?" In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, Paul calls his son in the faith and ministerial protege Timothy to faithfulness in ministry. In verses 2 through 5, you will find 9 commands that he gives to Timothy, bidding Timothy to be faithful to his call. But the first of those commands, I dare to suggest, is the most important of the commands. The opening words of verse 2, "Preach the word." The remaining 8 commands here expand, amplify, emphasize that primary command to preach the word. Biblical preaching is the primary, central, and definitive function of the church. Here, we are reminded the difference it makes when our ministries are fleshed out in confidence, unwavering confidence in the Word of God. Would you consider with me, first of all, right out of the text, the significance of faithful ministry? In verse 1, Paul says, "I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom." This is the platform from which Paul will issue the commands that fill up the remaining verses of the paragraph. He says, "I charge you." It is to solemnly testify. But he does not issue these commands to Timothy based upon his personal influence. Paul and Timothy had a close personal relationship. Paul was Timothy's spiritual father, pastoral example, ministerial mentor. However, He does not charge Timothy to be faithful in his call on the basis of their personal relationship. He calls Timothy to faithfulness on the basis of transcendent realities. God the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, the final judgment, the second coming, the consummation of the kingdom. On that basis, he says to Timothy, I charge you. I think about this passage and have thought about it recently. Last month, I had the privilege of preaching in Detroit, Michigan. I had not been there in some time. And I met friends who I knew years ago. And we reminisced about a major personal turning point in my own life that took place as I visited the city of Detroit, Michigan. The date was June 11th, 1989. I cannot forget it. It was a Sunday night. I was resting in the home of the late Dr. Roy Allen, who had invited me to do a youth meeting at his church, the Chapel Hill Church there in the city. My rest was pleasantly interrupted by a knock on the door. Dr. Allen was staying in his home. He awoke me to tell me that my father was on the phone. I was eager to talk to my father that night. He had gone into the hospital earlier that previous week. It was the first and only time in my life my father had ever been in the hospital. I was eager to hear how he was doing as he had come home that Saturday as I was flying to Detroit. And then I had my own issues I was concerned about. I was a 16-year-old boy preacher who had never been that far away from home that long to preach. And as I heard my father's voice, I just broke into tears and told my dad I was ready to come home. He reminded me that I had six more sermons to preach before I was scheduled to come home. I told him it didn't matter. I wanted to come home now. My father said, son, I want you to do me a favor. Be a man and preach. I said, yes, sir. He said, no, son, promise me that you'll be a man and preach. I promised. We exchanged I love yous and good nights. I went to bed not knowing that that would be the last time on earth I would ever speak to my father. That Saturday, as I flew from Detroit back home to Los Angeles, God called my father from his earthly labor upstairs to his final reward. And in the succeeding years, as I think about my father, as I often do, what most naturally comes to my mind is that final conversation, be a man and preach. I grant you, I concede that that might have been just simple advice to get his frightened son through a difficult week. Little did we know how God would use those closing exhortations to get me through the succeeding years of dangerous toils and snares in ministry. Be a man and preach. This must have been the sense that Timothy had when he received this scroll that we know as 2 Timothy from the Apostle Paul, which most likely is his final correspondence. And he charges him. But note here that Paul is wise enough to know that Timothy will go through some times of difficulty where he would need more than just the memory of a dead apostle to help him remain faithful. And so he says, I charge you in the presence of God the Father, in the presence of the living God, in the presence of the creator, sustainer, and redeemer of heaven and earth. He is saying to Timothy, remember that when I have moved off the scene, God is still watching. When I am no longer around, God is monitoring your faithfulness. This is what we must remember, brothers and sisters. Ultimately, we are not accountable to a board or to a denomination or even to our own expectations for ministry. We must answer to the Lord Jesus Christ for our faithfulness to the calling he has placed on our lives. Paul says, I charge you then in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. That statement is significant because it equates God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ as co-equal and co-eternal. Here, Paul affirms the claim of Jesus in John 10, verse 30. I and the Father are one. three ways. That's evidence. He says both God and Christ Jesus will judge the living and the dead by his appearing and his kingdom. Just pause there for one moment. What could be so important that Paul would weigh down on Timothy's shoulders the gravity of eternity, God the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, the second coming, the consummation of the kingdom? Well, notice what he doesn't say. You know, let's exegete the white spaces for a moment and consider what he does not say. He does not tell Timothy to lead meetings, organize programs, build buildings, visit the sick, counsel the troubled. All of that has its place in pastoral ministry. But the primary charge for which we will have to answer to the Lord is our faithfulness in handling the message he has given us. We must preach the word. On one occasion, a young minister visited Charles Haddon Spurgeon complaining that he did not have a congregation as large as he thought he deserved. Spurgeon asked him, "How many do you preach to on the Sabbath?" He said, "Only about 100. To which Spurgeon, it is said, replied angrily, "Young man, 100 souls are more than enough to answer for at the judgment seat of Christ." And while so many these days are preoccupied with size and success and celebrity, may we hear these words and be reminded that when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, he will not ask us the size of anything. He will only ask us about our faithfulness to the charge that we have been given. And so we see here the significance of faithful ministry. May the Lord help us to be faithful to the message that we have been entrusted with, so that we might end our ministry as Paul does in verses 6 and 8, declaring, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have loved his appearing." But not only would you consider with me tonight the significance of faithful ministry, notice with me in verse 2 the substance of faithful ministry. What does it mean for a minister of Jesus Christ to be faithful to the divine calling he has placed on our lives? Verse 2, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. This verse answers three important questions about the substance of faithful ministry. Here's the first: what should you preach? The answer? Preach the word. I know that answer is obvious, but it is still important. By saying, preach the word, he is reminding Timothy that the power of preaching rests in its content, not in the presentation. He is reminding Timothy that it is the message that makes preaching effective, not the mere function of preaching. He is reminding Timothy that it is not our preaching that makes the gospel work. It's the gospel that makes our lousy preaching work. And so he does not just tell Timothy that he must preach. He tells him what he must preach. Preach the word. It means, first of all, the content of your message must be biblical. The pulpit is no place for worldly entertainment, self-help talk, motivational chats, political speeches, scientific theories, or theological speculation. The word here, preach, refers to the herald who declared the king's message, and he did not have editorial authority over the message, and neither do we. Martin Luther said it well, the pulpit is the throne of the word of God. The content of our message must be biblical, but the meaning of the message must be biblical. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a workman who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. Here we are reminded that just because a man stands up talking about Scripture and mentioning Scripture and referring to Scripture does not mean he is preaching the word. We are only preaching the word when the point of our message flows from and is in alignment with the truth of the word of God. Ultimately, there are only two ways to preach, by exposition or by imposition. Either we are declaring the God-intended meaning of the Scriptures, or we have determined our own message and imposed it on the word of God. This is a serious matter. I had my flight information way ahead of time before this trip, but a key piece of information I did not get until I arrived at the airport JIA this morning, but it became vital once I arrived at the airport, the gate number. You don't figure out the gate number weeks in advance. That's not a priority, but when you get to the airport, that gate number becomes very significant. You don't determine that you showed up at the right airlines on the right day and you can just go through any gate and hop on a plane. It does not work like that. You go to the specific gate. This morning when I left Jacksonville International Airport, I took off from gate A3. And I didn't say, well, I'm here on the right day at the right airlines. All the gates look alike. I could just go to A4. It will not matter. Of course, we don't do something foolish like that, because just being one gate away from the gate you are intended to be at can actually lead you in the opposite direction of your final destination. And likewise, any mishandling and misrepresentation and misinterpretation of the word of God can lead people away from God rather than closer to God. So not only must the content of our preaching be biblical, but the meaning of our preaching must be biblical. And of course, the focus of our preaching must be biblical. If I may quote him again, it is said that on one occasion a critic said that to Spurgeon, that all of his sermons sounded alike. To which Spurgeon said, and so they should. Because in every sermon, I do the same thing. I call a text, and as soon as I can, I make a beeline to the cross. May that be the rightful criticism of our faithful preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. May we, in these critical days, boldly proclaim the divine nature, virgin birth, righteous life, atoning death, physical resurrection, glorious ascension, intercessory ministry, and imminent return of the Lord Jesus Christ. What do we preach? Preach the word. Here's the second question in verse 2. When should you preach? Verse 2 answers, be ready. In season and out of season. This be ready alludes subtly to the importance of preparation. Donald Gray Barnhouse, who also served the 10th church, on one occasion said, if I knew Jesus was coming back in 3 years, I would study for two and preach for one. Emphasizing the importance of making sure you get the message right. But not only is this a call to preparation, in as much as you can't be ready if you don't get ready, it's a call to perseverance. Be ready in season and out of season. When you have an when you have an opportune time. In fact, in season is the same term used in Mark 14, verse 11, to describe how Judas waited for a good opportunity to betray Jesus. In season and out of season. That is, if people want to hear it or not, preach the word. If you are experiencing a season of harvest in the life of your church, by all means, do not be like the rich fool and become preoccupied with building bigger barns. Just keep preaching. Or if you're going through a dry season in your ministry, for God's sake, don't try to manufacture artificial fruit. Just keep preaching. That's right. William McDonald said it well, that the word of God is in season at all times, even when it appears to some to be out of season. Ezekiel 2, verse 7, the Lord says to the prophet, "You shall speak my word, whether they will hear or whether they will not hear, for this is a rebellious house." We must preach in season and out of season. Of course, friends, we want to be faithful and fruitful. But the charge of the text says we must remain faithful even when it seems we are not being fruitful. Remember, the harvest is not at the end of the service or the end of your tenure or the end of the year. It's at the end of the age. So you must faithfully preach the word in season and out of season. How should you preach is the third question of verse 2. Rebuke. He says, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. Reprove is to show one his error with the hope of persuading him to turn around. Rebuke is to confront error whether a person receives it or not. But then at the same time, we are to exhort, coming alongside to help those who have fallen and pointing them to the cross where Jesus paid it all. And we do that through complete patience and teaching. Note here in this second verse that Paul reminds us that faithful preaching requires biblical teaching. There is no hard distinction between the two. They go together. But what if preaching and teaching is not enough, HB? Paul says here it isn't enough. You need faithful teaching and complete patience. Long suffering. He is reminding us that the word of God works. It just doesn't always work according to our vision, schedule, and expectations. This is why we must preach the word in season and out of season. But finally, would you notice with me, not only the significance of faithful ministry and the substance of faithful ministry, but in verses 3 through 5, and I will summarize these verses. In verses 3 through 5, there is the struggle of faithful ministry. What an important word this is for the times that we live in, where Paul charges Timothy to preach the word and then says to him, if you obey this charge, it will not be easy. Why? Verses 3 and 4. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching. Having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. Paul is warning here about professing believers who are actually walking in a false presumption of salvation. His concern here is not so much what people in the world are doing, but people in the church. He is concerned about spiritual hypocrites who will be exposed by their refusal to endure sound teaching. He reminds us that there is a sense that faithful preaching of the gospel will draw people in, but it'll also run some people away. And They won't go home. They'll go looking for teachers who will tickle their itching ears. The idiom here of itching ears is a curiosity for something new and pragmatic and sensational. Sometimes I occasionally hear preachers talk about having a fresh word. I get nervous when I hear that terminology. If it's that fresh, maybe you need to let it sit a few centuries so that we'll know it stands the test of time. We don't need anything new. The Bible says a lot about false teachers. Here's the other side of the coin, where Paul says that false teachers would not have influence if church people didn't give them a platform. Marvin Vincent comments about this verse, that when the people want a calf to worship, a ministerial calf maker is always available. Jeremiah 5, verses 30 and 31 says, a horrible and astonishing thing has happened in the land. The prophets prophesy falsely. The priests rule by their own authority. That's bad enough, but that's not the tragedy. Here's the tragedy. The Lord says, and my people love to have it so. And then the passage ends with this question, but what will you do in the end? Oh, brothers and sisters, this is why we must be faithful. Doesn't matter what's happening around us now. We need to do our ministries with a view to the end. And with that view, verse 5, Paul says, always be sober-minded. The word here is the word for sobriety, but it is used metaphorically to speak of alertness rather than abstinence. It is a soldier who is faithfully guarding his pulse. Greek scholar Kenneth Weiss comments here, interestingly, simply, he summarizes this exhortation by saying, there is no place for clowning in the pulpit of Jesus Christ. Always be sober-minded then. Endure suffering. We are not called into ministry for worldly success, material prosperity, or ecclesiastical prominence. We are called to be soldiers of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we must endure hardship, endure suffering as faithful soldiers. We must do the work of an evangelist. Here, Paul's concern is not whether or not Timothy is gifted as an evangelist. It is a part of his pastoral duty. You are to preach the gospel to the lost and teach the gospel to the church. Colossians 1:28 declares, him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom that we may present everyone perfect in Christ Jesus. And then there's one final exhortation, and maybe it summarizes the others. Fulfill your ministry. You get no credit with God for how well you start. Anybody can start fast. The question is, can you finish strong? Fulfill your ministry. It was the opening round of the 1500 meters in the 1972 Munich Games. 10 men were on the track, but all eyes were on one man, Jim Ryan. He had been a world record holder, had been undefeated for 3 years until he lost in 68 to Kip Keno, Kenya. The world awaited the rematch in 1972, but it was not to happen. During that opening round race, Ryan stumbled over Billy Fajor of Ghana, fell to the track while the rest kept on running. The crowd watched to see how Ryan would respond. And to their amazement, he got up and began running again and didn't stop until he crossed the finish line. He knew at that point that he wouldn't win a medal, But he determined he could at least finish what he started. What a joy that truth should be to us. Because in the race that we run, if you finish, you win. You may build great cathedrals, large or small. You may build skyscrapers, grand and tall. You may conquer all the failures of your past, but only what you do for Christ will last. You may seek earthly fortune and fame. The world might be impressed with your great name, but soon the glories of this life will all be past, and only what you do for Christ will last. Though your armies may control each hemisphere, and your orbits out in space cause men to cheer, your scientific knowledge may be vast, but only what you do for Christ will last. Though your songs and prayers are heard and praised by men, they all have no meaning unless you've been born again. Sinner, heed these words. Don't let this harvest pass, for only what you do for Christ will last.
Amen. How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to ask Pastor Tim Ma if he'll make his way to the stage to lead us in our prayer of thanksgiving for the message. Just a few announcements. Tomorrow morning at 8 a.m., we're asking you to convene in Faith Chapel. It's that direction. We'll have folks at the Welcome Center here to help you find there for our prayer time in the morning. That's at 8 a.m. at Faith Chapel. And then in the morning, our session resumes in here at 8:55. So we want to make you aware of that. Now, after we pray, we want to invite you to a few different reception opportunities. Right out here in the crossing, we're going to have reception. That is our general reception available to anyone. In Phelps Hall, which is where the Great Commission dinner was tonight, is going to be our international partnership gatherings. Urban Ministry with Dahati Lewis is going to be in the loft. That's third floor out in that building. Once again, we'll have folks out here to help get you to the right place. And our ethnic pastor's reception out here in the crossing. Pastor Tim Ma, you come now, my friend. Give thanksgiving. Let us stand, congregation, and let us give thanks to the Lord for the priest's word. Pastor.
Thank you, sir. Well, I'm sure glad I don't have to follow that preaching. Thank you, Dr. Charles. Thank you, Dr. Smith. Thank you, Dr. Autry. Thank you, Dr. Fitzgerald. Your words tonight were inspiring by God's grace. Let's pray. Oh, Holy Father, our Father, we thank you for the love that you continue to pour into our hearts. Lord, just as you delivered your people, Israel, through the Red Sea, you will finally and completely deliver us in Christ Jesus. Lord, help us in our churches each day to be faithful. That's much of what we heard tonight. Faithful preaching of the word, faithful as a community in prayer. Lord, help us to be so. Lord, help us to preach the gospel, the cross, and the resurrection. Lord, the truth is that your word says in John 3:15 that the Son of Man must be lifted up so that by believing, those that believe may not perish but have eternal life. Lord, help us be faithful to communicate in our preaching the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Lord, there are many who are hurting here tonight, suffering in different ways in their ministries, Lord, I do pray for them. We pray together, Lord, that burdens and bondages and shackles will be lifted from pastors, elders, deacons, and leaders in the church. They will come before you, Lord, with a repentant heart, that they will turn from their sins and turn towards you. Lord, help each and every one of us, help me, help us to be so. Help us to have a repentant heart in Christ Jesus. Lord, we thank you for gathering us together under the banner and the leadership of the SBCV. Lord, we thank you for a denomination that is committed to the Bible, to the Word of God, to its authority, to its inerrancy. Lord, please help us to take this word, your word, to a lost and dying world, that the name of Jesus Christ, that the cross of Jesus Christ will be lifted up, and that men and women will be saved. We thank you for these things, Lord. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.